Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the next community meeting on this wonderful July 16th. Let's get right into it. A couple of things about etiquette. You know, if you're going to speak, go ahead and introduce yourself first. My name is Chris Friday, and I'm the community manager for the Open Search Project. Try to mute yourself. Keep yourself muted unless you're actively speaking. That keeps things quiet. Cameras, of course, are optional. If you want to show your face, great. If not, that's okay as well. Questions can come in at any time in the chat. People will be in there to answer or interact with you, or you can come up and ask your question via audio. And of course, don't be disruptive. We'll get rid of you. A couple other things that we've done for different moderation features and measures that we've had to do in the past. Turned off screen annotations and profiles will only show names. Excuse me. Only co-hosts and hosts can share their screen. And we do have additional co-hosts in here to ensure that we have a good and uninterrupted meeting. You all know you had to use a passcode to get in, and we've stopped the allowance of people renaming themselves. We don't want impersonators in here, not today. A couple of announcements. Well, the first couple here are the OpenSearchCon North America is coming up quick. So if you haven't yet, register now. We'll put a link in the chat. And also, we have a room block set up, so you have a discount on room rates for OpenSearchCon. We really hope to see everyone there. It's going to be a great event. We're shooting for hundreds of people. It should be a wonderful event. This will be now our third year of doing it, and also our third one this year. So here's one for you. A couple of other neat things coming. If you're in Seattle or anywhere near Seattle, show up tomorrow. Joshua and Aparna and Nate and a bunch of people are going to be meeting at the Bellevue office for the next user group. Should be a fun time. A couple of us also have submitted a abstract to FOSSI. It's a nice open source event here in the city of Portland. And we're running a supporting user groups track from August 1st through 4th. So if you're not doing anything and you want to show up and support a really cool open source event here in Portland, this is the link for it. And then a few other things coming up. The next Dublin user group is in September. And we have one in London on October 17th. And I didn't put it in here yet, but I think Paris is going to be right around that London time as well. So exciting things to look out for if you're in those areas. Pavel, sure they'll see you at the September event. Two speakers, well, three speakers, two topics today. First, we're going to get into it with Henrik and Joshua about some upcoming features that they're building and they want to get everyone's input on. Following that, Samuel Herman is going to cover some storage format extension thoughts. He's got an RFC and a few things that he wants to talk through and get feedback on as well, and kind of give a high-level overview of the topic. So with that, I'm going to pass the mic over to Joshua and Henrik, and here you go.
Hey everyone, my name is Joshua Bright. I'm a product manager within the OpenSearch service team. Great to see everybody virtually. I feel like I haven't been here in a little while, so it's good to be back. So I'm joined here with Henrik from Eliatra. When over the past 6 months or so, especially as it pertains to our Spark integration, we've had a number of customers who are asking, like, how can I better enrich the data that I have with my cloud native storage, as well as enrich the data that exists within OpenSearch. So like between indexes as well as between an index and cloud native storage. In addition to that, we've also heard feedback that JSON search is quite difficult and frustrating to work with, especially when it comes to nested objects. And so what we were proposing, I've opened up a couple of issues within the SQL hyphen PPL repo that talks to both of these scenarios. Like how can we help customers who and community members who are interested in enriching kind of security events or compliance events, whether that be with mapping codes like numerical codes with data that they have stored in a static index, or being able to help add enrichment to IP addresses to kind of like indicate which service provider it's coming from. So we already have the GeoIP or the Geo mapping plugin, which is great, but sometimes customers want some additional enrichment and they want to be able to manage it themselves. So we have a proposal for a lookup command, as well as an early sneak peek proposal at some of the JSON search functionality. And Hendrik will go ahead and kind of dive into what those proposals look like, and look forward to some additional feedback from the community. Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, Joshua. Henrik, if you want to share your screen and
Thank you. This is Hendrik from Eliatra, island-based company for OpenSearch develop support and custom development and a few other things. As Joshua said, we are working currently on the PPL lookup command and on JSON functionality for SQL and also for PPL. Let me share my screen. Let's start with lookup. So I'm not sure if anyone aware of you is aware that there is the fantastic SQL sub pro project or the SQL plugin for OpenSearch which give you the availability to query the data with SQL. But not only with SQL, also with PPL. That's the pipe processing language. There is quite a lot of stuff already implemented for SQL, of course, as well as for PPL, but no lookup command so far. That means that we, as Joshua said, that there should be a possibility to enrich data by looking up additional data in an additional lookup index in OpenSearch. There's the issue 2651 from Joshua, and we started with a design proposal as well for the design, of course. So that means the software design as well as for the syntax. And we already implemented quite a lot of the things we proposed so far. And also, as Joshua said, it would be great if we can get some feedback of the community if this is if you're on the right if on the right trail or track, or if there's anything missing and things like that. It's not yet released, so it's work in progress. It's not yet merged. We aim for the next, what is it, 2.16 release. If that is not going, then it will be 2.17, hopefully. And yeah, let's start with lookup. So there will be an additional command, PPL command. For all who are not aware how PPL is working, maybe I give you just a quick example. So what you can do is you can do something like that. That means you go from left to right, and you separate different commands or expressions by the pipe symbol. That's why it's called a pipe processing language. The origin is, of course, when you deal with shell environments in the Unix world, you do exactly the same. So you have a command which issues typically data to standard out, and then you do something with the data, and then you do another thing with the data, and you pipe it through a process to a process chain, and at the end, hopefully, you have the output you want. And that's probably it's basically the same. We start in PPL with OpenSearch. We start with the expression that is just called source, and then gives the source index. And then you can have all commands which are at the moment supported by OpenSearch. You can, of course, it's like SQL. It's of course similar what you can do in SQL. So you limit it to you can have where clauses. You can have filters, you can limit it to specific fields, something like that. And what we now did is we added an additional command called lookup. And whenever the processing pipeline reached those command or those step, that means you have already input data, the current search, we call it. And we do something with the current search, and the current search means we have one or more rows which are the current search results so far in our processing pipeline. And then we, with the lookup command, we can enrich them with additional values. And that is what Joshua said. If, for example, typical example would be look up, you have a, for example, you have an IP address in the current result data, and you want to get a geolocation for that or something different. Or you have a, or you have IDs and you need to look up a different table, in that case, and different index. Where you can map those IDs to names or something like that. And what it now finally looks like and what we propose is that we have the command lookup, then we have an index name. In this example, we try to map logins to users, for example. And then we need to specify at least one field to correlate the data. That means every row in our current search result needs to have a field or more fields which we can use to map a particularly a document from a lookup index. It needs to be one field at least, could be multiple, and if they're have different names, then we can use the S keyword. So we map URID to ID. That means in the lookup index, the field is called ID, UID, and in the current search result, it's probably ID, but they should try to match. And if there is a match, if there is a single lookup document which fulfills those match criteria, then by default, all value fields and values of the lookup document will be added to the row of the current search result. Then we can tweak a few things. So we have an append-only parameter to specify if we want to overwrite current information or just to append them in case that we have fields in the lookup index which are named like the fields in our current search result. And we can, of course, also limit the fields who should be copied over. So by default, it's just everything, but that's normally not something you want. So that is the syntax. Apart from the syntax, it's not too hard to implement it in the code because the everything you need is already there. So that means we have especially one class, the Open Search Index, the Java class, where we have access to the client, which allows us to perform the lookup call, which is nothing else than just the search in OpenSearch. That is the way we implemented it. Why I'm saying this? Because it's therefore not implemented as a join at the moment. This would be another option to implement the lookup. Then it's of course not a real lookup, so we do more or less a real lookup. The other possibility to implement it would be just to join data. That means join the search result and the lookup index together, left join, left outer join, and see what the result is. That is something we do indeed when we will implement the lookup command in the Spark. For Spark functionality. So Joshua asked us also not to help out with the lookup command for OpenSearch, but also for the Spark project, OpenSearch Spark. That means we will also integrate this command into Spark, so it's then possible to use Spark. All data sources which are able to connect to Spark as the source of the search result, and then do the lookup in Spark. But that is it's our there's already a PR for that, but that's in a pretty early stage. If you like, please of course have a look there and leave your comments. So much at the moment for lookup. I just let me just finish JSON, and then we can probably if there are questions, then let's do it after the JSON support explanations. For JSON support, it's something like that. That means we are currently missing JSON functionalities to deal with data which comes in as JSON. If speaking of OpenSearch, that would be then something like JSON in JSON. So JSON blobs as a JSON string in a text field, something like that. And the idea is to have various JSON functions, like for example JSON extract, which you can use in the select clause. This time we will implement it for the SQL language as well as for the PPL language, because it makes sense for both, of course. We started indeed with the JSON extract functionality. We have also a proposal for that and a working prototype. Let's go with the example. And the example would be something like, okay, the input is JSON. I can have also static input like in this example, but typically it will come from an open search field, of course. And then the idea is for JSON extract to support JSON path as well as JSON pointer, because those are the I would say de facto standards to query JSON documents to extract the value or substructure you want to have from the JSON document. So that could be, of course, something like the result could be a scalar field, like a string, like a number, like a Boolean value, something like that. But it could be, of course, a substructure. So it could refer another JSON object. It could refer to another to a JSON array. And then you would if you want to deal with nested data, for example, you would then just use the appropriate JSON path or JSON pointer to define what you want to have from your JSON structure. Or if this is not possible, you can also use the JSON extract output for another JSON extract input. So if JSON extract outputs a substructure, not a scalar value, you can use it as the input for another JSON extract or another JSON function, of course. That is possible because the input and output of the JSON extract and probably all other JSON functionalities are implemented in a way that the in and the output is indeed string. So it's untyped, but it gives you the greatest possible flexibility to do everything what you want to do. Because if we start with type functions, at least how it is definitely how it is implemented at the moment in the SQL project, then we will probably lose all kind of functionalities. So that means that is one thing I wanted to ask the community, or it's just an open question for me. Is this the right approach? Should we deal with a string in, string out? And the other question, for example, I implemented it at the first proposal is to build it as a simple built-in SQL functionality. The beauty of that is then that is more or less automatically available in PPL later on. So the real implementation is just we have to do just once for SQL and then PPL inherits it. Okay, that was a fast walkthrough on a high level to what is currently going on in the SQL project regarding PPL and JSON support. Not sure if there are any comments or questions, then I'm happy to answer them.
Thank you, Henrik. Community, does anyone have questions for him? Both of the links are in the chat as well if you want to look through those. But do we have any questions at this time? Thank you, Peter. Peter says, great direction, Henrik. Really like the direction you're going.
Okay, perfect.
This looks like a really useful thing for the community. And we really appreciate all your work on this.
Hopefully. Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
That's the thing I prepared for today. If we want to go deeper, we can, but we don't need to, of course. I think if there are no questions, maybe we can just go ahead with the other presentation for today. Oh, Joshua, I'm not sure if you want to say anything.
No, I think that was perfect. Thanks, Hendrik.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah. I have a hunch we'll have you back on when it's implemented so you can teach us all how to use it in the real world.
I will do. I can also give a demo then, so no problem.
Perfect. Thanks, Henry.
Sure.
Sam, you're up. If you want to share your screen, it's all yours.
Yeah, so this is like the main topic that I wanted to talk about, but I think that in order to kind of start talking about it, a lot of people probably need a lot of background. So actually, I'm more than happy to take some time actually at this beginning of this and explain a little bit background. And at the core, The interesting thing is just maybe first I'll just I even had like a deck, so we're not going to go through this entire deck. I don't think we have enough time, but we can go through several parts of it where hopefully we'll have enough context to move on. So just a little bit of background about myself for those of you that don't know, I'm working for Oracle. I'm architect for the Oracle Search Services and OpenSearch. Previously, I was architect of OCI Observability, and I worked before that for Amazon at EBS. So, just kind of like a bit of like, what was that RFC all about? So this RFC was more like the how to do it, but how to do what was really how to change underlying storage format in OpenSearch. So this was a suggestion of a mechanism to make that easier. But why would you even want to do something like that is actually a good question by itself. And kind of one common answer that, I mean, maybe I can give a few examples. So maybe one very, very dominant examples that you guys have seen is the work that was done with the KNN. So the thing with KNN, especially when we had to extend, right, when the OpenSearch project wanted to include implementations such as Face and Animusleap, right? Native implementations. Those were times where an extension of the native of the Lucene KNN format was needed. So just before we even talk further, is like, yes, I already kind of gave you a hint. Lucene is at the core in OpenSearch of everything storage. This is what defines how things are stored, how things are managed. But we're gonna get a little bit more deep into this. But first, a few more motivations. So KNN is one example, right? Where we wanted to switch to some native implementation of the storage format for us of a codec for a specific thing like KNN. There are some other examples too. So other examples could be like, for example, OpenSearch, as I mentioned, is using Lucene, and Lucene, as we will see, has a lot of codecs and a lot of things. But sometimes we might want to read these indices like that Lucene writes, that OpenSearch writes via Lucene by another system, like let's say Apache Spark. And they're actually today in the community, they're very well known formats like Parquet and Avro. And those are very popular. So Parquet is a columnar format, Avro is a row format. And we can actually use, like, if we had a way to write the some of the Lucene codecs in that way, we could have like a native integration. And it's always good to have this flexibility because sometimes you have implementations of various formats like KNN, like columnar formats, row formats that actually maybe at some point be ahead of the existing formats in Lucene. So this is all good, important reasons. Okay, so just a little bit first before we even go there. Just as a lot of you may know, right, OpenSearch, right, I mentioned it has index. Index is a collection of documents, right? There are shards. For this index is like divided, it partitioned into shards. Each shard is behind the scene a Lucene index, and Lucene indices are farther divided to this thing called segments. Now, you don't always have to go straight to Lucene when you want to make like some change, right? In not necessarily a format. Sometimes you actually want to start from a much higher level. Like, for example, you want to add a new data type, right? So new data type or a new field of mapping. So you can think about it this way, right? Like say in a programming language, you have these primitives like integers and strings, right? And then you have more complex things you can build on top of them, like, you know, like arrays and objects and I don't know, hash maps or whatnot. So same thing here in OpenSearch. So we have a Lucene that has implementation to all kind of primitive fields, right? But on top of that, you can have much higher level things like IP, right? The field in OpenSearch that represents IP or a date or a geo point range, all kind of things like that. For those, you don't have to go and like, you know, create add a new format to Lucene. For those, there's actually ability to add something called a new field type or a new field mapping type in OpenSearch, and those actually should be sufficient. So this is again, there is not always like a 100% formula, but kind of I'm trying to just let you know what the building blocks are. Okay. And then you know, if we go kind of a layer deeper, in OpenSearch, before we actually get to Lucene, we have something called the engine, right? So the engine in OpenSearch is really what's kind of facilitating, right, all everything that has to do with everything that has to do with transactions, with commits, merging files, fields, and all that kind of stuff. Now, the engine in OpenSearch is actually highly coupled with Lucene. It's not like an independent thing that assumes like, oh, I'm gonna use a different thing. So actually, Lucene has already interfaces that sort of implement a lot of those things. So the engine really depends on those. So just kind of going quickly, peeling layers in the onion before we actually get to like a little deeper. So yeah, so as I mentioned, right, like a lot of people, they don't really know what to make of Lucene, right? So when you go and you open up the Apache Lucene, then you find the definition that says that this is a search engine or a search engine library or all kind of things. But in fact, the way I see it as a framework with a bunch of interfaces that are actually all very, very extendable and let us, I would think about it almost as like, say, a mini database, like SQLite. Like it's very modular and you can extend different parts of it, right? So some parts of it, they define how you access the disk. This would be directory, for example. Some parts of it define indexing and search functionality. So there are APIs for that. Some parts of it really talk about commits and transactions and segment management. And I think for the discussion of format, then the two things I would like to talk to you about are fields and codecs. So if we can go slide. All right. So what are fields and codecs? So in Lucene, right, a field is actually the building block of a document, right? So we have a document, you all know from OpenSearch behind the scenes, they're all going to be translated in one way or the other to a Lucene document. And document is a collection of fields and values, right? So fields, as I mentioned, right, there's like Lucene supports all those primitive fields like text, string, long, in, double, sorted field. There are actually more, but text is not really a primitive field. But even that, even some of those fields, we can break to like something more primitive. But in any case, let's for now just, you know, from when you look up from OpenSearch, these all look like primitives to you. Now, the interesting thing is that when you think of a field, right? Like, let's say when you think of a first name, right? I can create a document and it can have a field called first name, a field called last name, phone number, I don't know what else. Now, when we think of something like first name, right? So the field can then, let's think what characteristics a field will have, because a field in Lucene is also an abstraction by itself. So a field can have a name, right? So, or a key, right? In that case, let's say first name is a key of the field. The field can also have all kind of characteristics, like it can be indexable. So maybe it's something that we're going to actually index and be able to search by, or it can be not indexable, right? It can be sorted, or it can be not sorted. We can also say, hey, can this field be stored, or is it just used for search? So there's actually lots of things that you can say about what a field is going to be like in terms of its functionalities that you can do behind the scenes on it. So again, if we peel it a little layer deeper, then a field is actually composed of various constructs, right? Depending on those characteristics. So what does that mean? For example, if this is a, again, let's take a string field like first name, right? That would be a field of type string. If that will be indexable and searchable, then most likely we will need an inverted index, right? For an inverted index, we will need a posting list. So in Lucene, right, there's going to be in the description of the field, right, the field can have a posting list. And that posting list need to have a codec, like some format. Is that field also going to be used for analytics or faceting? Then we're going to create a columnar format. In addition, we're not only going to store in the index and in the posting list, we're also going to store it in something called doc values. Now, if we want to fast retrieve that field only for search purposes, then we're going to use something called the stored field, which is a row format. If we also want to have neural search, right, on this field, then we're also going to store an embedding of it in a KNN vector, all in the same, all for the same field, right? So for each one of those low-level constructs, Lucene will have a codec. A codec is really how what is the format, right? That how those things are written, actually encoded to the disk and read from the disk. Okay, so we gave the example earlier of a KNN vector. There is also something called a point, which is a BKD tree, and we actually can find more codecs. In our example, so remember we were talking about if we look at the RFC, I was mentioning in specifically the Parquet and Avro. So these are the codecs that I want to include for both for the row format, which is the stored fields, and the columnar format, so that these would be the doc values. So I want to show you like just a quick demo. So what you're seeing here, right, is a sample app. Now in this app, what I did here, it's actually just pure Lucene, and I'm writing this index. So when I run the app, then you can see it's going to run, it's going to read some text files from somewhere, and it's going to create an index based on those files. And this Lucene index, what's kind of special about it is that I used something where I basically said, don't create a compound file. So I set that to false. Actually, let me do this. I'm going to set this to false as well. So I'm going to run it again. So what I do here is I'm saying, hey, don't create any compound file here. So just keep it plain. So now you can see that the index actually has all these different files. So for example, these two files, these store the doc values, right? The columnar format piece in Lucene. And this one, for example, these will store the store doc values, right? The raw format piece that I was talking about earlier. Now, let's say, for example, that I want to create this custom codec, right? So if I want to use a custom codec, then you can see really what Lucene lets me do. So when I think of a field, right, these are all the different types of format that can be in the field. So what I'm gonna do is, for example, for the doc values, I'm going to switch now to my custom doc values codec. And let's see, I'm gonna run this again and let's see what's gonna happen. So remember these two files, right? DVD and DVM, these are the doc values. And now they disappeared. And now I have only this file called custom. So don't worry, I actually have a check here that it's actually doing the real thing. It's really writing the data there. And this is something I can do. Now, another thing I can do even better is I also created this Parquet codec. So in this Parquet codec, what I'm going to do, I'm going to replace the stored fields format. So that's kind of an odd choice to replace the stored fields with Parquet, which is a columnar format, but we're not going to get into why I did that. Not in this talk anyway. And when I run it, what I want you to see is the columnar fields here disappeared. And what I have instead is this file called that ends with PRQD. And actually, if we had a bit more time, I would have actually shown you how I take a Spark shell, an Apache Spark shell, and open this file. So you believe me, it's really a Parquet file. It has a schema, and you can actually query it. But this is just really kind of like a simple thing that I wanted to show you. Now, we don't have like a whole lot of time. So what I'm going to do next is I'm just going to skip a little bit. Okay. So what we're going to do is I'm just going to skip a lot of that stuff. So we part of it we talked about. So there is a doc values, which is a row storage versus stored fields. They're good for different things. Again, there is a lot of things we can talk about here, but that we'll keep for a different talk. What I want to talk about now is really to kind of jump a little bit forward to the RFC. And really, let's talk about what are the limitations. So I shown you this demo and it's like, okay, that's super simple. And trust me, I mean, you can also do this in OpenSearch, right? You can push the same config and you can push your own codec, and that can be nice too. But what are the limitations, right? Why really create a new RFC for that thing if it's so simple? So the main limitation, right, as some of you probably already know or already guessed, right, is Java, right? So what we did here was simple because everything we did in Java. We wrote a new codec file in Java. We gave it to Lucene and it worked because, everything is compatible. And we extended the Lucene codec interface, right? This was all Java thing. So what happens when you need to do something like KNN extension to like that's implemented in C or C++ or some or Rust or who knows, or in fact any non-Java language that you cannot just embed right in your code and compile it into bytecode right with your project. So this is just a basic Lucene limitation when we come to extended. The other one, right, is OpenSearch, right? So when we think, so Lucene is kind of nice, it's Reality is relatively very tight, right? It has almost no external dependencies whatsoever. This is not a thing we can say of OpenSearch. OpenSearch has so many dependencies. So whatever plugin you're trying to write and add, for example, if we think of Parquet, there's going to be so many dependencies that are going to collide with OpenSearch, and that's going to create a jar hell. And you don't always have control of these dependencies. So sometimes there are some issues with like the code in those dependencies themselves. Like for example, they can have the same name of the same class, and OpenSearch is not going to want to start because of that. So this is actually a big problem, and it adds to that because that's how we include ex like plugins today in OpenSearch when we want to extend it. So one solution, right, that's probably super easy to think about. Okay, so you want like a non-Java, like a C++ implementation, Rust or whatnot. Fine, you compile that and you use JNI. That's been around forever. This is actually what was done with the KNN plugin. And just checking that I'm on time. And that's a very valid thing to do. But let me ask you this. What happens if like I want to extend to something in Python? Something that is not necessarily C or C++. Then what's going to happen is that the JNI is just adding another layer that is actually making it even harder for me to integrate. Like I can use it, but it doesn't really give me that much of a benefit as I get with like the C or C++. So there was actually another interesting suggestion that was going on in the community, and I think there is this thing called extensions. So extensions is experimental, and one of the interesting things about extensions is that it lets you to spin a process that implements it doesn't have all the OpenSearch dependencies, but some of them I mean, via a thing called the SDK. And you can implement, you can start a process, you can register it with OpenSearch, and then OpenSearch will start using it instead of like a plugin that is internally. Now, again, there are limitations with that too. It sounds great, but it sounds great for things that you don't really care about the locality of them. Right. So when we think of storage and we think of like, say, something like logging or something with like high throughput data plane, then you really need that fast local access to disk. So you don't want to like spin a process somewhere and have a node somewhere else trying to write to a process that is spun on another node. That is not really what you want. And also, it's impossible to do right now with extensions. So it doesn't support, codec extensions right now. I mean, obviously we can fix it, but we'll have to answer those questions, how we solve locality problems when we think of extensions. So then that's kind of like the last minute where I wanted to introduce this latest RFC. And this RFC is sort of like a hybrid. It's trying to bridge the gaps between, so JNI, that is something that, okay, you call it when you need it, it's on the node, it's very local, but it's limited to C++. And then on the other hand, you have extensions that is very, very it's like all over the place. You can spin it in like it can support any language, anything, because everything goes over the network, but it's very cumbersome with respect to the locality problem. So this is supposed to be like a hybrid with the external writer approach that you spin from the engine whenever you try to use like a non-Java implementation of some codec. And feel free to look at it. So these two things, so this is extensions, right? This is an important thing that we mentioned. And this one is the local external writer approach that is mentioned. So, yep, that's all for me.
Both of those links are in the chat, so thank you very much, Sam.
We're on time, but if any questions, I can take like a couple minutes to answer if that's.
Any questions coming in from anyone? We don't see any in chat right now. No. Well, we ran up till time, so we don't really have a lot of Q&A time right now. If anyone wants to stay behind and discuss anything, a few of us can stay on if we need to. Otherwise, here's how to reach out to us. Different social handles, different links for user groups and YouTube and all the important things. Feel free to reach out anytime. And with that, thank you all for showing up. Have a wonderful day. Hopefully, we'll see you at OpenSearchCon and then tomorrow at the Seattle User Group. Remember to register as soon as you can. Thanks. Take care, everyone.